Yeah, so the recording is started. Let me share my screen with you. Okay, the screen is shared. Okay. Can you see it? Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, so any yes, question sir. And comment from the last class? So in the last class, we discuss about the velocity addition law in special relativity. Okay, and we saw that velocity addition law modifies tremendously in special relativity, particularly when the velocity of the objects are comparable to the velocity of light. Student, don't listen, so I am muting you all. We saw that the velocity addition law has simplified the velocity addition law modifies in special relativity, and that modify law reduces to the Newtonian law in the Newtonian velocity addition law when the velocity of the objects or the frames are smaller than the velocity of much smaller than the velocity of light. Okay, we have also discussed about simultaneity, concept of simultaneity, then length contraction and time dilation. Okay, so we have covered sufficient amount of material, so I thought today let's do some tutorials. Okay, we'll do some problems. Okay, so one of the problem that I thought to do is from your assignment sheet. Okay, so just a minute. So let's say we have a problem number 7. So please open your problem number 7. Okay, so there is a similar question. So the question is a mean lifetime of muon. So this is question number 7 from tutorial, from assignment number 7. Question number 7. Okay, so the mean lifetime of muon at rest is 2.2 microsecond. Okay, the observed mean lifetime of the muon as measured in the laboratory is 6.6 microsecond. Okay, find the effective mass of muon at speed when its rest mass is this and this. Okay, so first of all, I will not directly tackle this question. Okay, I'll want to inform you something else. Okay, so this mean lifetime of muon, so that means this delta T naught is 2.2 microsecond, which means 2.2 into 10 to the power minus 6 seconds. Okay, so if you write with muon, okay, then you will see that this muon, this is an elementary particle, it just disintegrates to another elementary particle within 2.2 second microsecond. Okay, the velocity with which this muons travel, that is also high. Let me take the velocity as is given in by the, so I think this is 0.5, or I don't know what this is. They move very very fast actually, so near to the velocity of light. Okay, so let me see what velocity Beiser is taking, and then we can compare. I don't seem to find it, but let's, yeah,
so it's 0.998c, I guess.
Okay,
it's written in the book.
0.998c. Okay,
C. Yes,
sir. C. Yeah, so now this muon particles, they come into the picture, so they exist away far beyond the surface of Earth, maybe 20 kilometers, 30 kilometers. They are created in cosmic ray above the surface of Earth. Okay, but we do measure the muons at the laboratory. Okay, so if the time of the muon, if we just say, okay, the muons moves with this velocity and the muon have a lifetime of 2.2 seconds, then you see the distance of the muon is 0.998 into c is 10 to the power 8 into time, that is 2.2 into 10 to the power minus 6. Okay, so how much will you get? Let's say this is just 1. Okay, so it's roughly 1 kilometer. Okay, roughly, I know it's in kilometer. So this muon that is created above the surface of Earth should be able to travel only up to kilometers, 1 kilometer or something. Okay, but we do find muons, but we found muons even at the surface of Earth. Okay, so how is it possible?
Dilation.
It is just
there. Velocity is very high. Time is slow.
Yeah. So you have to see what this delta T naught is. So delta T naught is the mean lifetime of the muon in its own frame. Okay. So for us on Earth, we will say
time will be dilated.
The time is dilated. So for Earth, the muon has a lifetime. For Earth, observer on the Earth. Okay. For observer on the Earth, the lifetime of muon is 1 minus v square by c square. So this is delta t naught. Delta t naught is just 2.2 microseconds divided by 1 minus 0.998 square. I don't know what this number is. Can anyone calculate and tell me?
So it will come out to be 34.8 microseconds.
34.8 microseconds. Okay, 34. Let's say 35. Okay, so it's roughly around 35 microseconds. Now you see the big difference. So from our point of view,
the distance will be more.
So we'll see that this distance that the muon travels is what? It travels with velocity v and t, delta t. V is 0.998 into c is 10 to the power 8 into t is 35 into 10 to the power minus 6. And now you can see this is in what? 100, how much is this in kilometers?
10.4 kilometers.
Roughly 17 kilometers.
11, around 11 kilometers. Whatever it is.
Yeah.
So it 11. Is much, much higher than what we expect. Okay. If we naively use T naught in the calculation. Because from our point of view, the lifetime of the muon is 35 microseconds. Okay. And this was actually, since we can see muon in the laboratory, this was also an experimental prediction which justify special relativity, time dilation and special relativity. Okay. So I'm not very careful about the numbers here. You can check the numbers. I'm just giving you the flavor.
Yes, okay.
So number you can do by your own. Okay. So what about this is the calculation from our point of view, from Earth point of view. What about the muon's point of view? What will happen?
Length contraction.
But from the mu particle point of view, he will say the distance between, suppose a person is moving with muon. Okay, so with respect to himself, that person is at rest and the muon is also rest with respect to him. So that person will say, actually, the distance between him and Earth is actually the distance between mu and the Earth surface is what? That d has to be modified. So that d will become d naught into 1 minus v square by c square. Can anyone tell what is this d naught?
Sir, original length.
1 kilometer.
11 kilometers.
Think about it. What is d naught? D naught is the length. So it has to be 11 kilometers. 11. Okay.
11.
It is around 11 kilometers. Right? Because the distance between muon, so what is happening from Earth? From Earth point of view. And this is muon point of view. Okay. So this is a muon particle, okay, mu, and this is, let's say this is Earth, right? It's the surface of Earth. So from the Earth point of view, this distance is actually how much? 11 kilometer. Okay, so the relative velocity here is v is equal to 0.998 c. Okay, but from the muon point of view, this distance is actually, this distance is length contracted, and that would be 11 times 1 minus 0.998 square. Okay, so this distance actually decreases. So the time the muon will take to reach Earth, or the Earth to reach muon, would be what? T. Anyone? The time the Earth. That length.
T naught.
Minus 0.998 square. And then that's the length. Divided by velocity. 0.998. Okay. So that is what special relativity is. You have to think about from the observer point of view. You have to first ask this question: who is measuring? Okay, who is measuring? Whether the person on Earth is measuring, or the person who is traveling with mu is measuring the muon particle. Okay, so since we do see muons at the surface of Earth, it was also an experimental verification of the time dilation principle, time dilation result of special relativity. Okay, so you can do similar questions. So question number one, we have, if a rod, yeah.
Sir, from the muon's point of view, the length would be contracted.
Yes, the distance.
And the time, that will be dilated time? Or not?
You calculate the time? No, his time will not be dilated, no? If you are
his time will be normal, but the length will be contracted.
Yes.
And from the person at the Earth, his time will dilate, and the length will be same.
No. The person on Earth, okay, what he will say? He'll say that the muon's time is dilated. Okay, and he's traveling with velocity v. Okay. So the time it will take the muon to reach Earth from the Earth point of view, observer on the Earth point of view, would be that dilated time into the velocity. Okay, just think about it. Okay, so in the assignment you will see the question number is very simple. If a rod appeared to shrink by half along its direction of motion, what speed should it travel? It's elementary question. Question number two is easy. We have done it. Question number three. Anyone try to do question number three? Did anyone do question number three?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I did it.
Okay. Yeah. So what's the answer?
Sir, 2 by 3.
somebody
is saying 2/3c. Okay, that's fine.
Same.
Yeah, so it has to be e times v. Am I right? Or e times c.
No, sir.
Hmm? No. What I'm saying
sir,
is that
e is 0.667. Yes, so it's
e times c.
Yes, 0.667.
So, no, that is okay. 0.666. Let's say now e is 0.5. Then what would be the velocity?
E by c by 2.
Yes. So it's basically e times c. The frame velocity is e times c. Okay. Just prove it. You don't have to do anything else. You don't have to assume the value of E. Okay. Suppose E is unknown. Eccentricity.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Just prove it. The velocity would be E times C. Okay. Question number 4. You can do it. Question number 5. Okay. We just did question number 5, right? So the velocity here is 0.6E instead of 0.999. So we did it. Question number 7 we'll do later on. 6 we'll do later on. 7 is easy. 8 is easy. 9 is also we'll do later on. 10, 11, 12. Okay, I have one question. Actually, I like this question. Let's see. So this is a question from Beiser. Okay, it will just give you more physical idea what is happening. Okay, the question is, I think, number 52. Okay, so if you have a visor, you can open it. So the question is this. So this is a question number 52 from Beiser. We'll do 51 as well. Okay, so let's do 52. And question is, an observer detects two explosions that occur at the same time, one near her and other 100 kilometer away. Okay, so he's saying that there is an observer. Okay, so he detects, so suppose this is T, this is X, and he detects two explosions that occur at the same time. So let's say the one explosion occur here, another explosion occur here. So let us call it event 1 and event 2. This occur 100 kilometers away. So this distance is 100 kilometer away. Okay. Another observer finds that the two explosions occur 160 kilometer apart. Okay. So then there is another observer. Okay, let me write in this way. So there is another observer. I don't know who is moving and who is not. So let's also call it T and X. We'll give T prime and X prime when we'll know who is moving. Another observer find that the two explosions occur at 160 kilometer apart. Okay, so he finds that this event, event 1 and event 2, second explosion occur after 160 kilometer apart. Okay, now this event 2 and event 1 may or may not happen at the same time. Okay, so what the question is, what time interval separates the explosion to the second observer? Okay, so this is first observer who finds that two explosions occur at the same time, which are same time, and the explosion are 100 kilometers apart. And second observer find that no, the two events occur 160 kilometer apart, but he doesn't know what is the time interval between these two events. So the time interval in the first event is, so T2 minus T1 is 0. Event 2 minus event 1 is 0, and we have to find the T2 minus T1 in the second observer. Okay, any idea how do we proceed? Okay, first tell me, who is moving?
Observer one.
Why do you say first observer is moving?
simultaneously the both the talkers
because we heard
the length between two observer is small, they are occurring at the same time, they actually is small in the first observer. Okay, so that means that observer is actually moving.
Hello?
Yeah.
Sir, different events are occurring in the different frame, or the same event we have to observe from two different frames?
Two different frames.
Two different
there
frames,
is two
same event
just
or?
A minute. Two different events. Okay. So it's like, suppose you are at wherever you are at, where do you live? Hello? Suppose there are two explosion happens at Raulkela. Okay. One explosion and then another explosion. One observer says that these two explosion happens at 100 kilometer apart, but happens at the same time. Another observer who is moving relative to the first observer, he will say, no, this explosion occurs 160 kilometer apart, but with some time difference. They don't occur at the same time. So first, what is the time difference in the second observer? That is one question. Second, so yes, that's the question. So in order to answer this question, you have to first find the relative velocity between the frames. And in order to find the relative velocity, you have to first see who is moving. Well, the general idea is, since length is contracted, so if the distance between event 2 and event 1 is 100 km and the distance between event 1 and event 2 is 160 km, that means that this is moving. This is moving. The first observer is moving with velocity v. Okay. So what we can do? We can say, okay, let this is L. Yeah.
Sir. Sir, how did you know that this first observer is moving?
I just explain it, that the distance between two events, let's say this is a rod. Okay, the distance between two events, you can say, okay, this is a rod, it's a kind of rod. The length of that rod is 100 kilometer in one frame and 160 kilometer in another frame. Right? Now you can use your length contraction formula and you can say which one is moving.
Got it, sir.
You have to measure the distance. You have to measure the time difference.
Sir, this delta t. For that, we have to know that road is placed in the first frame or the second frame. Because for the first frame, it will be the original length.
Let's say second frame. You have to first think about the problem. Okay, before asking question, you first think. If I have to calculate delta t in the second observer, that means I have to put myself in the second observer. Isn't it? If you have to calculate delta t in the second observer, delta t in the first observer is zero. You have to calculate delta t in the second observer. So you have to put yourself in the second observer. So you are calculating everything from the second observer point of view. Okay, if not, then you think about it. Okay, if you don't get it, even after that you don't get it, you ask me again. So L is equal to L naught 1 minus V square by C square. So what is L here? Anyone? L is 160. 160. Yeah, 1 minus V square by C square. So solving this, you can find C. Okay, using this, find V. Yes. Now what do I do? I need T2 minus T1. That's the question. Well, your T2 is what? T2 prime. So you can say, okay, since this is moving, you can associate prime here, prime here. So the first observer is moving, so I associate a coordinate T prime and X prime. So this would be t2 prime plus v x1 prime divided by square root 1 minus c square minus t1 prime plus v x1 prime divided by 1 minus
c square prime by c square.
Yeah, sorry. C square. Yes. Thank you. Okay. So your T2 minus T1 would be T2 prime minus T1 prime divided by, okay, please mute yourself, plus V by C square. Okay. 1 divided by 1 minus V square by C square X2 prime minus X1 prime. What is T2 prime by T1 prime? Anyone?
Zero. T2 prime minus T1 prime.
Zero.
And then this is 1 minus V square by C square. And what is X2 prime minus X1 prime? This is
100 kilometer.
Now you can solve it and you can find T2 minus T1 prime. Okay? So, yes, so you can get it. Okay, so this is why I chose this problem. I chose this problem to show how simultaneity works. So you see two events which are simultaneous in first observer, they are not simultaneous in second observer. Okay, so you can also do the calculation in other ways. So I chose this way. There is a similar question. Yes.
Sir, if a person is holding a stick 1 meter and if he is moving with nearly to speed of light and we are watching it, so for us, the length would be contracted.
For us, the length will be contracted, yes.
And for that frame, if he watches us, and that case, what will happen?
Can you repeat it us? Can you repeat the whole experiment again?
Sir, if a person is holding a stick and
okay,
he is moving
so suppose
with
that length,
to speed of light.
Okay, so suppose that length, whatever that person is holding is L naught. Okay?
Yes.
Okay, now what is the question? So what is that
and
length with respect to...
If he is moving with nearly to the speed of light, for us, the length would be contracted.
Yes.
And I want to know that from if we change the situation that... he is moving and he is watching us. So what will happen that time?
What will happen to what?
Ourselves, if we are holding also a stick, means that
so
we will also,
whatever
our stick also will be contracted.
So, yes. So according to him, your stick is also contracted. Whatever stick you hold, suppose you hold a 1 meter stick, okay, so that person who is moving with velocity 0.8 or whatever it is moving, he will say,
okay,
no, the length of your stick is less than 1 meter. Okay.
And so we also watch it. We can also say that he is also in the first case. His length stick is also contracted.
Yes, both will say that the other person length stick is contracted. Okay, but you have to be very careful which length stick you are talking about. Okay, you have to be very, very careful. So as I mentioned in the previous classes, they are actually measuring two different things. If suppose in your frame, the length is L naught. Okay, the distance between two points is L naught.
Okay.
That distance between two stick from an observer who is moving with velocity V. Okay, suppose this is U. Or you can call T and X, and this is T prime and X prime. So that length, according to him, would be L naught 1 minus V square by C square. Similarly, suppose you have an observer, T prime and X prime, okay? And in his frame, the length is L naught, okay? And now, according to him, you are moving with velocity v in this direction.
In the opposite direction.
Opposite direction. So you will say, no, this length is actually L is equal to L naught 1 minus v square by c square. Okay, so both observer will say that the length is actually, for both observer, the length will be contracted.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. So there is also an interesting question. That is question number 51.
Sir, I have a doubt.
Yeah.
Sir, proper time will be defined for any frame of reference or only for in which someone is at rest?
Someone is at rest. Okay. So all observers will agree to the proper time. So what is proper time? It is the time between two interval, okay, which is measured at the same position, at the same point. That is very important. Okay. So for example, if you are here, so this is your T and this is your X. X. So the proper time for you is this time, delta T. Okay, the proper time for you is not this one, where your X is changing. For example, let's say this point and this point. This point cannot define your, this delta T, let's call it delta T tilde. This is not proper time. Why? Because they are not defined at the same position. This is not proper time. Is this clear? The definition?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So okay. We can also have a proper time for a moving frame of reference?
Yes, you can have. Absolutely. So the proper time for the moving frame of reference, let's draw it. What we have? So we have T, we have X, and this is T prime. This is X prime. The proper time for moving. So this T prime is also X prime is equal to zero line. So the X prime is not changing on this line, right? So that this difference, okay, is also the proper time. Okay, is also the proper time, is the proper time.
Yes.
Time in the moving frame.
Okay. So its projection on the T axis will give the proper time in the rest frame of reference.
No, not at all. Okay, so let's do question number 51. It's an inverse of 52. So it says an observer detects two explosions, one that occurred near her at a certain time and another that occurred 2 milliseconds later, 100 kilometers apart. Okay, so it says that there is a lady. Okay, her coordinates are T and X. And she detects two explosions. One occur at 2 milliseconds. One occur at, let's say, T is equal to zero. So let me put T is equal to zero here. At T is equal to zero, this is first explosion. Is, let's say, event one. And another that occurred 2 milliseconds later, 100 kilometers apart. So this point, okay? So she says that this is 2 milliseconds. And this distance, so this is event two. Okay, let me write event two here. Event two. And she says that this distance is actually 100 kilometers. Okay. Another observer find that the two explosion occur at the same place. I see. So there is another observer. Let's also call it T and X. I don't know which one is T and X and which one is T and X prime. So we'll put X prime later on. And that second observer. So this is your first observer. And this is your second observer. And the second observer find that the two explosions occur at the same place. Okay, so they are occurring at the same place. What time interval separate the two explosion to the second observer? Okay, so here the second observer find, let's say the first one event here, event one, and second event here, event two. So that they occur at the same place. The question is, what is this? This delta T is what?
Okay, sir, with so respect to first observer, the time difference is 2 milliseconds.
Sir, second.
No. Again, there are two explosions. Okay. So one observer say that the two explosion occurs 100 kilometer apart with a time interval of 2 milliseconds. Another observer says, no, the two events occur at the same place. The question is, find the time interval between the two observer from the second observer point of view. Is the question clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, what do we do?
Sir, the second observer is moving.
Second observer is moving. Okay, let's call it V. It's moving with velocity V. Okay. What else is given? So we have to find delta T. So let's call delta T prime. So this is T prime. Once we agree that the second observer is moving, we put the prime indices on that. Okay, so we have to find delta T prime. Very nice. What else is given? Given that x2 prime is same as x1 prime. Right?
Infinite.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So substitute the expression of x2 prime and x1 prime. So this is x2 minus v xt2 divided by 1 minus v square by c square is equal to 1 x1 minus v t1 divided by 1 minus v square by c square. This and this cancels out. So you see your v is, would be what?
X2 minus x1 by
divided by t2 minus,
t2 minus t1.
What is x2 minus x1?
100. 100 by 2 millisecond. 100 kilometer by 2 millisecond.
Okay, yes. So this is roughly would be how much? 0.5 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second. Okay?
Yes,
sir. Excuse me, sir.
Okay. Yeah.
Sir, in this question, we can't use the formula of length contraction. Because, sir,
yes,
both lengths are not measured at the same time.
Sir, how can the second observer? Which one? Can you repeat it again?
Sir, in this question, since the time is different at which the lengths are measured.
Okay.
Sir, for example, in first observer, there are two different ends are measured at different time.
Okay, fine.
So, sir, we can't use the formula of length contraction.
I'm not using the formula of length contraction, right?
So how can we say that second observer is moving?
Oh, we are using the time dilation. I'm not using length contraction here, right?
No, sir, when we say that second observer is moving.
Yes, but look at the time difference. Which is, just look at the time difference. Okay, so you do whatever way you want to do. Okay, the idea will be same. Okay, idea will be same. So let me go ahead and you think about it. Okay, so we have, so we found the relative velocity. If you want to do the other way, or the someone who asked question, you can do the other way as well. So what is now T2? The question is, what is T2 prime minus T1 prime? Well, you can again substitute the expression T2 minus V x2 by c square divided by 1 minus v square by c square and then minus t1 minus v x1 by c square divided by 1 minus v square by c square. Okay, so everything is given. How is everything given? This is t2 minus t1 divided by this 1 minus v square by c square. So t2 minus t1 we know, and then minus v by c square x2 minus x1 divided by this 1 minus v square by c square. So everything is given, then you can compare the answer. Okay, so compare the answer with your visor and see whether you are getting the correct result or not. Okay, I seems to get the correct result, but you should check with yourself as well. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Another question. Yeah.
Sir, do length contraction and time dilation can happen at same time?
They are. Okay. Can you specify a situation?
Means, sir, if a observer is at rest and he is watching a person who is holding a stick, let it be 1 meter.
Okay.
And he is moving to something velocity nearly to speed of light 0.8 to 0.9
c. Mm-hmm.
We see, we are at rest, so we are seeing that his length stick is contracted. And
yes.
For that time say, dilation, and for the time dilation,
we'll
what
also,
will happen?
We'll also say that his stick. You have to be very careful who is measuring. Again, So that L, when the initial L, suppose someone is moving. Okay, so you have to specify what is the length of that stick in his frame. So if in his frame, that person measure the length, and if he says, okay, the length is 1 meter, then only you can say in your frame, the length is 0.8 meter or whatever. That is, it is contracted.
Okay.
Okay.
And is this clear now? Dilation?
Yeah, you will say that his clock runs slowly.
Slower.
Yeah, it's okay, second. His second needle ticks slowly.
Slowly.
So if you
means,
forget,
sir,
if you
both the phenomena can happen together.
Yes. It's if in one frame length contraction happens, in another frame time dilation will happen. Okay, so if length contraction is happening, time dilation will happen. Maybe not your frame, but in other's frame. Okay. Is this clear? Means you cannot have a relativistic situation where you have only length contraction. You can have a length contraction in one frame, but in another frame there would be a time dilation. So you just see the problem that we did, this muon particle. So from our point of view, there was a time dilation, but from a muon point of view, there was
muon
a length contraction.
Particle point of view, there was length contraction.
Length contraction. Okay, so. Okay. If in one frame, length contraction can happen, in another frame, time dilation can happen. Okay?
But they don't happen at the same frame.
They don't? Again, you have to measure. If I am measuring, then the chances are no. Because if I am measuring, I will say the length of the stick is 0.8 meter.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay? So that is not length contraction. I will say the length is just 0.8 meter.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
So it means it is simultaneous.
Sorry?
Means time dilation, length contraction is simultaneous. If one is happen, the another will be happen in other frame.
Simultaneous is a wrong word here. Okay. Simultaneous has a meaning in relativity. Two events that occur at the same time, they are called simultaneous. Okay. So simultaneous might not be a good word here. Okay. I think the correct word would be, if one of these two effects, length contraction or time dilation is happening, then the other will
complement.
Happen. Complement. Yeah, they will complement. Yes, complement might be a good word. Okay. So there is a question number 20. Let's say question number 20 in assignment number 1. How much time do we have? Oh, 15 minutes. We can cover it. So, question number 20 or question number 22. Let's say 22. Concern number 20 you can do. Question number 22 is good. Okay, so as seen from Earth, this is from assignment, okay? As seen from Earth, two spaceships A and B are approaching along perpendicular direction. I see. So let's say there is Earth. Let's call it T and X. Or XY, what? Okay, XY. Let's call it YX. Okay? Two spaceships A and B are approaching along perpendicular direction. If A is observed by the stationary of observer to have a velocity uy, okay, is minus 0.9c, and B to have a velocity ux. So it says that this is Earth, and according to Earth, there is a ball B who is moving in x direction with velocity ux is equal to 0.9c, and there is a ball, okay, there is another ball A who is moving with velocity uy is equal to in negative direction with velocity minus 0.9c. Okay, question, determine the speed of ship A as measured by the pilot of ship B. So question is, what is the velocity of B? What is the velocity of A? City of A with respect to B. Any suggestion?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
If we join from B point to the Y point, there will be, I thought angle will be 45 degree. Then we will divide the Y or the Y and X component so that this.
No. It is much more easier. Just you imagine you are at Earth and you see two balls. One is moving in y direction, a ball in minus y direction, and a b ball is moving in x direction. Question is, what is the relative velocity of A with respect to B? That's it.
So how should we proceed?
Sir, we can solve as B is a moving frame and A, yes, and A's velocity is known in rest frame, and we can find its moving frame.
Yeah. So what we can do is, let Earth be a rest frame, okay, and B is a moving frame with respect to Earth, moving frame with respect to Earth, okay, and it's moving with velocity. What is the velocity of B with respect to Earth?
0.9c.
Okay, so the V, that the relative velocity between Earth, the relative velocity between Earth and B is Ux is equal to V is equal to the, this is your frame velocity. You can say frame velocity. And this is 0.9c. Very nice. Now the velocity of A has to be determined with respect to B. So what we have to do? We have to calculate ux prime. Ux prime of A. Okay. So prime means we are calculating with respect to B. Would be what? Anyone? Ux of A minus B divided by 1 minus V u x of A by c square. Okay, so again,
yes sir,
u x prime of A is the velocity of A with respect to what?
With respect to B, moving frame.
Yes, and what is u x of A? It is the velocity of A with respect to Earth.
Respect to Earth.
So what is UA of X?
It's minus 0.9.
UA of X.
UA zero.
Minus V. V is 0.9. 0.9c, and this is 1 minus 0. So this is
0.
Ux prime of A is just minus 0.9c. Okay, now we have to calculate Uy prime of A. So this is what? Anyone remember? So this is u y of a.
U y of a minus
1 minus v square by c square. 1 minus v u x of a by c square.
By c square.
Okay, now this is what? Anyone? What is u y of a?
U y of a is minus 0.9c.
1 minus, what is v square? V square is 0.9 c square by c square. And this is 1 minus 0. Okay, so you can calculate this. What is u y prime of, u z prime of z? This is just u z of, this is a.
A.
1 minus v square by c square divided by 1 minus v u x of a by c square, and this is just 0. Okay, so this is not 0. Okay, so we saw that u x prime of a and u y prime of a are not 0. So what is the velocity of a with respect to b? Well, this would be u
square,
I don't know, u a is square root of u x prime,
is the square root of the sum
square plus u y prime a square. Okay, so that's the velocity of b, a with respect to v. So last year I gave this question in a test. We used to have test in the normal times, and almost you might feel that this is easy. Okay, this problem was easy, but almost 90% of the student could not solve this problem. Okay, so if you could understand how we are solving it and why this is we are solving the way, then you can rely, you have understand the velocity addition problem. If you understand this problem and you can correctly solve this problem, then you have understood the velocity addition formula. Okay, so yeah, last year, around 90% of the student could not solve it. So yeah, I think this is a good time to stop. Yeah, we have, yeah. So yeah, so our discussion on velocity addition, length contraction, time dilation, simultaneity, Lorentz transformation is over. Now we'll discuss what is called Doppler effect, and how the kinetic energy and the momentum and the energy, total energy modifies, this expression modifies when you go to special relativity. Okay, so thank you. We'll meet on Tuesday, next Tuesday.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, if you have a question, you can stay, otherwise you can leave. Okay, thank you.
So, can I go now?
Yeah, your attendance is being recorded.
Okay. Sir, we have a class tomorrow.
No, we don't. Last time I took an extra class, okay? So that there are only three classes per week.
Okay.
Sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. Sir, can I ask a question from assignment? I was a bit confused. I mean, I want to verify.
Yes, I will tell you clarify the question, but I will not clarify the answer. Okay, yeah, go ahead.
Yes sir, it was a question, it was question number 2. It was the a part, I guess. Sir, the length would be shortened, right?
Yeah.
Yes sir, that's it. Sir, the last to last class you just told it would be gamma times L naught cos theta, so I thought it would be magnified.
No, only the x component will be gamma times L naught cos theta, but the y component will be L naught cos sin theta. The length would be the square.
It should be 1 by gamma, right? Because it has to be shortened. Gamma is always greater than 1.
No, it will not be shortened. That's what I'm saying. Na? So there are two components to the length. So the question is this. Okay, so what do you have? You have, so this is problem number 2. Question number 2. So what you have? you have a moving frame. Okay, so this is y prime, x prime. So that moving frame has a length L. Okay, this is L naught. This length is L naught.
Yes, sir.
Okay, and it makes an angle theta naught prime. Okay, you prime can take theta prime. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So the question is, what is the length of this rod with respect to the rest frame? So this is y and x.
Yes, sir.
Okay, and this is moving with velocity v. So obviously, this length, the horizontal length and the vertical length is L naught cos theta naught prime, and this is L naught sine theta naught prime. Okay, so from the rest point of view, this length, this horizontal length is contracted.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, so it is contracted, and this vertical length would be remain unchanged.
It remains same. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Remain unchanged. Okay, so what is Lx? Lx would be Lx prime gamma 1 minus v square by c square. Lx prime, so this is your Lx prime. Okay, and this is your Ly prime. So this would be L naught cos theta naught prime 1 minus v square by c square. Your Ly would be just Ly prime, which is L naught cos theta naught prime. So what is L, length of the rod in your frame? Lx square plus Ly square. That's it.
Sir, but they are moving. I mean, from their point. So, sir,
you don't have to worry about what they are thinking. You have to worry about your own frame. Whenever you do relativity question, you have to ask this question, who is measuring and what is measuring?
Yes, sir.
Now you are measuring at rest. So what they are seeing, it's their story. Okay. So right now you are concerned with what you are measuring. So you will be measure, if the length is L naught cos theta prime in their frame, it would be shortened by a factor of 1 minus square root of 1 minus v square by c square. Is this clear now?
Yes, sir. So it be always that the gamma factor should be always be divided or multiplied. It varies from situation to situation as per who is measuring.
Situation to situation? Yeah, see, that what I told you, whoever measure, suppose you are at rest and I am moving, okay? And I told you, okay, I phone you and I told you that the length of the meter stick in my hand is 1 meter.
Yes, sir.
Okay, you will say no. In your frame, you will say no, the length of the meter stick is 1 minus v square by c square. That's it. It's not 1 meter.
It's longer.
It's shorter. Not longer, shorter. If it is 1 meter, it is less than 1 meter. Okay. Now I can ask the same question. Suppose you will say to me, no, I am holding a 1 meter length. Okay, you will say I am holding a 1 meter length.
Yes,
you will say you are holding a 1 meter length and I am moving. I'll say, no, you are not holding a 1 meter length. You are holding a 0.8 meter length. It is shortened to me.
Sir, the same concept should be applied here.
Yeah. So we are applying the same concept here.
Sir, so it should be shortened. That's where I get confused. So it should be shortened from my point of view.
So it is shortened. Huh? It is Lx prime 1 minus v square by c square. So square root of 1 minus v square is less than 1, right?
Yeah. Sorry, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Sir, can you explain the last question again?
Which question again?
The last question.
Which one? This question number 2?
No. The last question, you are explaining the all question. Yes, this one.
This one. Yeah, yes. So what did, you didn't understand? Could you repeat? You do one thing. You try to solve it by yourself. Okay, you try to solve it by yourself. You try to find the velocity of ball A with respect to B. That's it. Or the velocity of ball B with respect to A. You try to do it. Okay, so once you solve it, then you will have much more confidence in solving relativity problem, velocity addition law. Okay.
Okay, sir.
If not, if you not able to solve it, then you can look at this file again. I'll share this PDF file. And even if you don't understand, then you can ask me again. Okay, but first try to do it. That's why it is from assignment question. It's an assignment question. Is this okay?
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So try to do it. And if you didn't understand or get it, then you will ask me again.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, you're welcome. Yeah. Anyone else? Okay. If not, thank you. We'll meet on Tuesday.